Hello, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is Muhammad Shiban, and I'm here with Vernet. We are this is session 3 of our book session thing, and it is Thursday, August the 27th, 2015, of course. It's around 11:40 a.m. And today we're going to be talking about the streets of where I grew up and, you know, from birth until I was 18, because this is a time when I left Alexandria to Cairo. Again, I was born in Bahari at grandma house, which is very, you know, the harbor district, Alexandria harbor district, and it's very, it's like a fisherman and all sea stuff over there, and it has all the old neighborhoods and, you know, the longshoremen's and the bosses and coffee shops and all that. It's a, you know, it is very culture and you know, old traditional neighborhood, and this is where you know, when you say you are from Bahari, it means that you have a history and people kind of you know what
you're from. What was the name of that? What was the name of that city?
Bahari is a district. It's the Gomruk, which is, you know, it said the sea.
B-A-H-E-R-Y.
Bahari.
Bahari, okay.
Yes. Now, we moved to, my dad was in the military at the time, and I think he was about to get out, and we moved to the house that I spent, we spent all, in fact, my mom's still there. You know, my brothers and sister, you know, it's a family home. Mm-hmm. And that was in Sidi Bishr. Sidi Bishr is, it's a, I would say, incorporated area of Alexandria.
Unincorporated.
And it was still like sand and very close to the beach. Sidi Bishr is the name of the town, and even the streets weren't already, there was no streets. The name of the area we used to say Ard al-Mahamara, meaning it's a big parcel, huge parcel, like, you know, maybe 10,000 acres or so, and they call it the Hay, or the it's like a neighborhood or a small city, or district, small district. That's what they call it.
H A.
Al Mahamara. L A L.
Oh, L.
A A L.
Yeah.
M A. H A. M. A R A, Mahamara, Ard al Mahamara.
That's a district.
Yeah, this is, was like a neighborhood.
Or a neighborhood.
Yes, and there was no streets or anything. It's just houses spread not very close to one another, in the right on the sand, and beautiful, like, you know, close to the beach. And this is where our playground. We have the whole, you know, neighborhood is our playground. We used to play soccer mostly in the sand there, and, you know, all our activities were right there. And when I was, I would say I started to going to the beach with my brothers, without my mom or, you know, older person with us, when we were, I would say started going really when we were like 5-6 years old, you know, started in elementary school, and during the summer we just go with our trunks, swimming trunks, mm-hmm. and slippers, and sometimes barefooted, because we're just walking in the sand. Right. And across the street, which is two streets, major streets, Khalid ibn al-Walid was one of them, the first one. And then the second one was the Corniche, which is riding right by the beach. And they have the cabins and then the sand, you know.
It's very hot, though.
Not really, because Alexandria, again, is Mediterranean. So, mm-hmm. you know, the weather there, it's mostly, they think it's tropical, but it's not as tropical as Florida or here. So it was really very nice and breezy, and it's not humid like, you know, when you go places. It was very much like California, a little warmer than California, because California gets very cold sometimes at mm-hmm. night and early in the morning. Alexandria was very moderate, very, you know, mm-hmm. very moderate climate. So that wasn't you know, an issue for us. And we, you know, boys, young boys, you know, there is nothing, you know, breaks or we don't really, we tough, we can survive anything, you know, we are adventurous.
Yeah.
That's how the scenery was in Alexandria, in Sidi Bechet, where I grew up. Now, to go to the movies or to go to the center or to go and, you know, restaurants and all this, the shopping district and all this.
Entertainment center.
That's what I took the word. I was trying to get, I don't know. that was in Mahattat al-Raml. Mahattat al-Raml is, it's still on the coastline, and that corniche goes all the way from Abu Qir, which is, Abu Qir was, we're going, man, I can see now, okay. So this, the beach was Bahari, so, and Qibli, and the sun, so it's west. Abu Qir was east of Sidi Bechet and Alexandria. It's at the far end of the city of Alexandria, the province of Alexandria, because Alexandria is a province.
How do you spell
that? Abu, A-B-O.
O, or U?
No, Abu, A-B-O, okay. Qir. Qir is Qir. Let's see, K. Or Q, Q, U,
right.
I'm sorry, Q, Q, U, E, E, R, Abu Qir. And that's also the fisherman places, like they have a lot of, you know, it was surrounded, it was like a peninsula surrounded by water.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, they used to call it the Dead Sea. When it goes around, it's a Mediterranean, but it used to call it the Dead Sea because there was no waves, and it's around Abu Qir. So that's where it ends. And then after that, I think, no, wait a minute. It was a way to go to other cities, and that was like 100 and some kilometers east of Abu Qir, and they call it Rashid. That's where it used to get. But let's stay within Alexandria.
All right, yeah.
Now, most of the time we used to go to, now in between Sidi Bechet and there is a tramway runs from Sidi Bechet to Mahattat al-Raml, and then it goes even further down west. And there is another, this tramway, it was the double-decker, and it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a British, I think it was, or Brazilian made, but it was British. They made the line, and it's classical. It's like, you know, the buses in England. Yeah. So. And we used to ride that and go to, in between now, like maybe, I would say 10 to 15 kilometers, that was a lot of schools. It was a lot of beautiful hotels and resorts right by the, you know, by the Mediterranean Sea on the shore. And they have Stanley, they have Genocles, they have all these beautiful places, sporting. There is Cambyses, there is Ibrahimiya, all of these beautiful places. And we used to go to, if we don't want to go to all the way to the center, which is Mahattat al-Ramj, we go to these places, Cambyses, or these places. It's a little before you get to the end of the yes. And also our, we used to skip the school during the during the middle school, and we used to go to the movies. The boys would get there, jump the fence, and go to the morning show. And then they come back before the school is over, and then go home like nothing happened. And that was the one thing that we used to do. Now also, I used to be, you know, we used to do, we have the train station, right? You know, the train goes from Abu Qir or Rashid, so further down, all the way to the center, which is Alexandria, like Union Station, like here, Union Station. And then it has many stations that, you know, the train stops, and that's the major motor local. And I seen the old motor local, you know, the engine with the core thing.
Right.
Yeah, and that was, I think that, I seen that until the, maybe the late 50s. I was a young lad, you know, and I seen it. And then they have the other ones, you know, that they, you see.
The diesel ones,
yes. Now, we used to go on the train station and jump on the train, because it was a lot of cargo trains, like, you know, and they go and leave cars, and then they take the cargo cars. You know how they go and gather and leave some on the tracks, and then they come back. And we used to go and jump on the train and drive the conductor crazy, and go with the train, speed up and get out, and then jump again on the train. We used to, when we ride the train, I used to go to school, we used to go and play games with the conductor so we can get free. You know, like we stay here and then we jump on the station and we know he's coming this way, we jump, you know, out and then ride behind him and keep playing these games. There is, but we didn't go to that extreme, but there was a lot of people who used to go on top of the trains. And they play games when, you know, when the train is going, and, you know, make flips and everything on top of the trains. And there was a lot of accidents that get the bridges. They go and they don't realize that the bridges, and there is a lot of people. A lot of kids got killed on that. But the school, though, the school, the student, they were kind of, we were tough. I mean, we would take any fight with anyone. And but we were dignified, not like the street boys, you know, the gangs and all that. We were, you know, we know how to handle ourselves, the good fellas. And we used to do everything that they do, but we were more dignified. Except going on top of the train, that's not, you know, something that doesn't fit a student, you know, going up there. But now, one of the things that it was really famous about Alexandria, everybody carried kids switchblade. And that was in, you go anywhere in the country, when they know that you are from Alexandria, they back off, because they know that you are so good in that switchblade, and that they don't want to mess with you, you know. And that was some that for a long time, it was, we just carry it to show it. It was the one with the ring, you know, and when you get it out, when you used to play games with it, like a, you know, like a draw, a gun, and, you know, these, you know, flips and all that stuff. And we get it out, your pocket is open, and I mean, it's already out. And then you, you know, and that was a very, it was a concern, but we kind of train ourselves to fight and be, know how to deal with somebody who is switchable and take it from him and beat the crap out of him. Mm-hmm. We're that good. So this is what some that is really, and one time I have one in my pocket, and my, the person I told you, like I was my godfather.
Yeah.
And he said, why you have this? You know, I'm a dignified now student, and I'm clean cut, and I'm, you know. Mm-hmm. And he was alarmed to see me carrying this, and said, Muhammad, you know, people, they carry these things, pickpockets in the train, so when they get caught, they can get it out and, you know, hurt, you know, whoever, and run away, so they wouldn't, you know, or drug dealers, you know, so they, you know, they can protect their, you know, and
stash,
yeah, and you are not any of this. You are a very responsible, young, smart, and educated young man, and you come to the mosque and. And he said, I want you to get rid of it. And I did. I was so embarrassed that he caught me. And I said, oh, I just kept it. You know, I took it from somebody and I kept it. And he said, no, I don't want to see it again. And that was it. I never carried it again.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, that was the way. But you see, all of this contributed to have no fear. We become the life there. It made us very brave, and we stand. You see, this is one of the things that I don't think you see now there. If you're going down the streets or in a bus or anything, and you see someone picking on someone else, especially if somebody bothering a lady, a girl or a lady or so, the people themselves were police. Oh yeah, they would grab the, you know, beat the shit out of somebody committing, you know, doing something to someone. So the people themselves, or police themselves, if there is a car accident, you find everybody gets aside, even the guy that he has a horse and a buggy, right, or a donkey and a buggy, he will park his his little carriage or whatever it is, and go there and push the car and get it out the way and get people out. If they hurt, they call the ambulance. I mean, the people are so...
That's a community.
Very, very, yeah. And you don't see somebody, you know, get stabbed or someone in the street and nobody even notice or...
Yeah, it's funny here, you know, you have to be told that there's, you know, your legal responsibility to call the police. If you're witnessing a crime.
Right.
First time I heard that was just a few years ago.
Right.
We never had to do that before.
Yeah, it's, yeah.
We didn't have to be told that.
Yeah, it is, because, however, I thought, you know, I knew, because people were coming, because I'd never been since 79 when I left. Never been back to Egypt. And I heard the life so much change, and that there is no even, there is no safety, there is no respect for the elderly, there is no dignity, there is no somebody stand for what's right, none of this. Mm-hmm. In fact, everyone now trying to rape or rob even their own families, their own brothers, their own father, their own daughter, their own, it's unbelievable how we became. And that's some that is, it came with all the, I don't want to blame it in the West, but it came with globalization and the culture now that is here in the United States of America. You go anywhere in the globe, And it's similar. It's like you're going to anywhere in the neighborhoods of California or Detroit.
Everything has been Americanized.
Everything has been Americanized. And that's...
Including the bad.
The bad more than the morals and values, yes. And this is because of the media and the hip-hop and, the housewives and all this show, Jerry Springer's and all that.
Yeah.
And this is... everywhere. There is no, and the internet and YouTube, it's a perfect example. You go and watch anywhere, you wouldn't know where you are unless they announce or they say that we are. So,
right.
It's very, very disturbing. There is no, no values no more.
Worldwide corruption.
Thank you. And that's what...
Probably the first time it's ever been there.
It is, has not been this way. Yeah, it is very, very disturbing. Very disturbing. Because now the bad, it's promoted, and the good and the morals are criticized and fought vigorously.
A filthy worm like Jerry Springer.
Yeah.
And that's all he lives for.
They're getting paid. And
he's the mayor of Cleveland.
He was, yes,
well,
I know.
He was.
Yeah, but you see, it's not the personality or one person. Jerry Springer is one of a system of that it's the system itself that it deploys these individuals, because in Egypt, that started way in the, in the early 1900. You see, that's the fall and the end of morality. It went in the same time everywhere. Like United States, we were talking about how the old traditions and the movies and how the modesty and dressing and how things were looked at, and it doesn't matter what your religion is, but with morals and values and traditions. That is very similar where I come from, and I have no, when I look at these things, I'm not surprised, because it's who I am. That's how I grew up, and that's how I learned. And I always, and that's why I'm very critical on people that they come from the Middle East, especially the older crowd, not the youth. The youth are... their minds is open, and they see, because they grew up here, they Americanized. They are so critical of things, but yet they are not sincere. They are not really, you got to be a role model. You got to be, instead of sitting there and criticizing, they are Americans, they are, whatever, they are non-believers. Hey, come on, man. The human beings, they are human beings, and we are human beings. There is nothing distinct us or make us better than them, except the creed that we have. The beliefs in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what makes us the best of nations. The creed, the belief. And it's not because we Arabs, not because we are Ajam or Persians, or we are Europeans, it's because of the unity on the morals and belief on that creed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-aqidah, which is the.
It's because it was all one.
It is.
Oneness.
It's oneness. It's oneness. It's the same message that came from Abraham until Muhammad. It's the same. It's a father of the prophets, and it's a nations after nations after nations, and they are all come from the same, we all came from Adam, but we came from the same thing with one
same.
Single unified message. Inhabit the earth, love one another, live in peace, enjoy the bounties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow upon all of us. And there is no difference between Arab or Ajam, Arabic, or foreigner, or Europeans, or Persians, or Africans, or except by the piety, the taqwa, the fear, and the iman of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is the sustainer, and mm-hmm. you know, the Lord, and the judge. And yes, that's it. That's basically what it is. So when this ayah in the Quran say, kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas, why? You were the best of nation that brought up for people. Why? Not because where we come from, not because of our ethnicity or background or nationalities. Mm-hmm. It is ta'muruna bil ma'ruf, you command what's righteous and goodness, and forbid what is wrong and what is evil. And tu'minuna billah, and you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the three things that makes us the best of nations. Now if this is that's okay. If this is what it is, anyway, I don't want to go on a big lecture thing.
Let's
stay with the subject.
Geographical.
Yeah, so that's what Alexandria. Now, when I was 18, I went to Cairo. I don't know if you want to do that another session, because...
Yeah, no, we want to know a little more about the streets, some of the places that you might go in Alexandria. Any specific, shop or any specific
store, oh, okay.
Or restaurant, the name of it.
Oh, yes.
And you remember who owned it. And
yes. Yeah, okay, alrighty. That's a good thing.
Yeah, a lot of anecdotes.
Alrighty. Well, I used to go to my aunt's house, mm-hmm. And she used to live in old Alexandria, near the Midan. The Midan is like the square. And it has all the vendors and, you go there, everybody in, like, booths, and it's mm-hmm. like when you go to the bazaar or the county, like a city of Anaheim, farmers market. And and they have the olives and the pastrami and all that good stuff. Everything is sold in there, even clothes, even jewelry, everything. Mm-hmm. There is one also that is funny, the name of it. In Alexandria, they call it Zanit Sittat. Zanit Sittat, Zanit Z-A N-E-T-T-E. Zanit L-A-L Sittat S-I-T A-T-E, sit that.
Okay.
And that's the mean, the women crowded place. So everywhere you go there, they have all the little jewelries and Victoria's Secret stuff and, perfume, everything sitting there. And you can barely walk because it's so crowded with females, huh? And I used to go with my mom. Yes, and I used to go with my mom when I was little. And man, it was a beautiful place because you see a lot of beautiful women and young and old and everything, and they're all going shopping for their, beauty and dressing.
Same thing. Malls are made for women.
Yes. Now, the places that I used to like eating, there was a place, they call it Muhammad Ahmed. Well, it's like Muhammad Ahmed. Muhammad Ahmed was a restaurant that in Mahattat al-Ramth, which is that entertainment center, whatever you call it, and where the movie theaters and all this place, and it was they sell sandwiches, beans, the feva beans. I don't know if you ever eat feva beans.
Uh-huh.
Yes. and falafel. So the, you know, and it's
my
a
favorite.
Oh yeah, they make it in a little like pita bread, but it's small, and they will call it shami. Shami is like from Damascus. Damascus is sham. They call it blood sham. Mm. So the bread itself is white, okay, and it's small pita bread, mm-hmm. and it's kind of thicker than usual pita bread. Right. And then they open it and they put the food and they cut. Oh, it's so good! And they have the pickles, you know, the beets and all this right. stuff, and the tahini sometimes, you know, the hummus or baba ghanoush. And we get these sandwiches, and you can eat like many of them, and you don't even get hungry. I mean, you don't get full because it's so delicious. Oh, we used to love that. And it was very famous. People come from all over the country, and you go eat at Muhammad Ahmed. And it was reasonably priced, even though it's in a, you know, in a very high, upscale neighborhood, you know, in the center, you know, mm-hmm. every, you know, all rich people go, and everybody goes there and you know, shop. So this is one of the places, and that was in Mahattat al-Raml, the station of al-Raml, which is the station of sand. Okay, now, that's, we used to go down with the boys and, you know, walk in the city and go to the right. movies and, you know, at night, and this was a nice place. If you have, we didn't really date because dating, yeah, we date, but not as liberal as urban.
Huh? Don't you need a chaperone for that?
What you mean?
On a date.
No, if you are engaged and, you know, the father, you know, and he wants to send her little brother with you, you know, so you want, you know.
Right. Yeah,
yeah, that's was the case. But we used to go, you know, in the school and everything and meet the girls and, you know, we can see them in the neighborhood and walk and, you know, we talk to them and we'll have girlfriends and everything, but it's all hidden, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And we don't do the sexual thing. It was done, but because back then, yes, back there, it's very wrong to marry a non-virgin. So if you go and you did some that her brother will kill you, or her family will kill you. And it's, in fact, there is places in Upper Egypt, you don't mess with this stuff. You don't, because you will be shot right, you know, right there. Because they call it.
No matter if you want to marry her anyway.
That you're too late. Mm-hmm. You want to marry her, you go to her father or her brother, you know, your family house, and you say, well, I met, you take your mom or your dad, your family, you take your family and you go ask for her hand. That, you know, how did you see her? I heard, you know, I saw her and, you know.
That when she's a virgin.
Yes, yes. There's no way that you're going to go and, you know. Now, if someone has a baby, and that, back then, I don't know about now. Now it's like here and even worse, because back then, things were totally different. You know, I'm talking about now the 60s, late 60s, early 70s. That's when, you know, things were, you know, totally, it's not an open society like what we see now. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that here also was still preserve, you know, it wasn't that, you know, it wasn't that the honor of a female. You can't even go and talk about her without, you know, without four witnesses. You know, you don't go say, oh well, I F her or what have you. This is unacceptable. You know, it's. And this is our deen, our religion. It's an, you know, you can't go and throw accusation in her honor. That's, you know, yeah. So this is one of the values, and that is not preserved and promoted. And that's why our societies, globally, That's why there is no wholesome in our lives. Because, you see, if we, and this is what I learned from Imam, many Imams, but the one that I really listen to all the time is Abdul Hamid Keshk. Abdul Hamid Keshk, he's the blind. Abdul Hamid, H-A-M-E-E-D, Hamid.
E-E-D?
Or I-D.
Or I-D, yeah.
I-D.
And he's a blind?
Yes, the blind sheikh, Keshk. Yeah, you've probably seen him. It's very...
Oh, the guy.
Yeah. Not Omar Abdurrahman, no. Omar Abdurrahman, the one that did the trade, the accused of doing the trade center? Mm-hmm. No, no. This is... They never left Egypt, this guy. And he was from the 50s. He graduated from the University of Al-Azhar. And he was an imam of a masjid. You know, he was an imam of a mosque. and he was politically...
Just as an aside, that guy that Hisham brought, he was a maniac.
Hisham?
Hisham, yeah.
Yeah.
The one he brought to the mosque. You weren't there.
Oh, the one that...
he was just screaming and yelling. And
oh, that Hisham translated for him?
Yeah.
His name is Sheikh Alaeddin. Sheikh Alaeddin from Egypt. You see, I know
Alaeddin.
Yeah, Alaeddin, I know him when he came. All of these imams, especially from Egypt, they are very educated, and they are when they come, first come, very good imams. Very sincere. Mm-hmm. Then they come here, and then they fight among themselves to get the mosque, and they become, they get bought. They take the carrots, and they fight among themselves. It's all competition about how much they're gonna get from the government.
Well, that was my impression. My impression was that he's a guy who, you know,
a fanatic.
Militant.
Yeah, no, that he's. He was, when he wasn't a militant, he was very strong and very
sincere.
Aladdin. His name is, Sheikh Ali. He's a big guy, right?
Yeah.
Big guy and kind of middle age, not very old and not very young.
No, he's middle age.
Yeah. Alaeddin, Sheikh Ali. And he has a very deep, very
voice. Oh, you can hear voice. Him outside.
Yeah, he's very loud. Yeah. He is in Rancho Cucamonga. I think they're building a new mosque, right? In,
really?
Or Fontana, or some...
Fontana, you belong.
Fontana, yes. Yeah, Fontana, yeah. So that's...
There are some of those thugs over there.
Yeah, that's right. They're all
over there. Look at the guy we've got here.
Yeah.
And we got 500...
Yeah, but 500 brothers they all belongs to the same... North America or whatever, they all, you know, they... I'm not going to even go there because...
Yeah. I'm sorry, that was an aside.
Oh, no, that's fine. It's okay. So that's what... why we get... Yeah, Sheikh Keshke said, if you want to... if you want to destroy a society, introduce them to fornication, zina, the youth, especially youth, and al-khamr, which is liquor. Mm-hmm. And of course, everything else, gambling, everything that Islam or Quran,
You're talking about young people.
Young people.
You know who said
young,
that?
Young people.
You know who said that?
No.
Karl Marx. Did you want to destroy a country?
Infecting
after them. Their young people.
That's it. That's what it happened.
Yeah, yeah.
And the British realized that very well. The British are the masters of that. The British are the masters of that. They do
Marx,
it all over the colonies.
Guess where Marx was?
Yes.
For his whole career.
Yes.
London.
Yes. See? That's exactly what happened in the whole globe. In fact, this was a British colony. Right. United States of America was, you know. So we have to realize. However, though, you see, we enable the British is an empire. They do everything to control, you know. They are an empire. Mm-hmm. However, if we did not drop our deen and not being sincere, and we got, you know, the leadership, and the one that they are, the scholars and the people that they know, the deen. If they didn't sell out, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us victory. You see, because in the Quran it's very specific. وَمَا يُغَيْرُ اللَّهُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيْرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not change what in people unless they change it themselves.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's go back.
Okay.
Let's just say you're 8, 9 years old. You got bicycles?
We used to rent bicycles. That's another one that I wanted to talk about.
Okay. No, well, let's say you got, you know, half a dozen of you, but all about the same age, about 9, you know, and you're gonna go around Alexandria. Where would be a good place to go? You know, when you like, where would you get some free snacks or, you know, whatever you want?
Was when I go to the center of the city at my aunt's house. Mm-hmm. I have cousins, and you know, we used to go and rent to the. First, we used to rent to the tricycle. Tricycles, you know,
and
tricycle or paddle. It looks like a. Doesn't look like a bicycle. It looks like a little car with the front, you know, and it has a steering wheel. Oh, sometimes it's a handlebar, but sometimes it's a round steering wheel. Mm-hmm. And we would go in the city with the tramways and the buses and everything. Mm-hmm. And and that was some that we couldn't do in Alexandria because Alexandria was mostly sands, and, you know, and we can go in the streets, but on bike.
In
the city.
Not in City Beshri,
yes.
Yeah, not in City.
Yeah. But then in City Beshri, we have a bike shop right by the train station. And I used to go rent the bike there for an hour, 2 hours, mm-hmm. and pay from my allowances, a piastre or 2 piastres, you know. And one time, old bike, I'm talking about the old black 28 or 32, you know, and we ride on the handle in the middle bar because mm-hmm. we can't sit in the chair, you know, in the seat.
I know all about that.
Sometimes we put our feet from the frame of the bike in the right pedal and the left one in there, and we're holding there, so we are not even in that bar, we're inside the frame, because that's how we reach. And anyway, that was so old, and I fall and I break the pedal. The pedal broke. Mm-hmm. So I took it there. Now that's a beating. Mm-hmm. You're taking the bike to the guy, and he said, "What happened?" I said, "Well, it broke, man. It's too old." Mm-hmm. He said, "Well, you got to pay for it." I said, "I don't have any money, but I will bring you 2 piastres every other week, or you know, until I pay for it. How much it cost?" And I was a little boy. I was like maybe 8, 9, 10 years old. Mm-hmm. And the guy shook my hand. And he said, "Okay, I'll see you every 2 weeks. I'm not going to tell your father. I'm not going to tell anybody. And I want you to come, Muhammad, and give me this money." Mm-hmm. And I went to there religiously. And I went to there a couple of times. And he said, "You know what? Just you showing up, man, it's okay." He gave me the 2 piastres and he shook my hand, and he was very pleased. And he, you know, because I was a boy of my world, I went to there and I, you know.
I was raised the same way.
Yeah. So this
same
is.
Same way, and incidents just like that. I did something, and.
This is the tradition, that's what I'm talking about. Our generation, this is that's how we live. It's unbelievable how we became, especially the youth. The youth, they just don't have that, you know.
The millennial.
The millennium. But you see, they got it from who? From their parents, their teachers, the Hollywood or the media. You know what I mean?
The entertainment.
Yes.
Totally.
Yes.
They couldn't have gotten it from me or my wife.
No. You know why?
They got it entirely from MTV or whatever.
Thank you, because look.
That's the corrupting influence.
Yeah, look.
The kid, all the time.
The kid spend with this in his home with his parents, very especially now, two working parents, you know, most of the time at the babysitter or at the daycare or at the school, and the rest of the time in the front of the TV.
Yeah, the babysitter is the TV.
Yes, that's it. Mm-hmm. So all the who they are is not what we implement or teach them or see us how. Excuse me, how we do things, because we're so busy trying to make a living, mom and dad. And then we become so caught up in our own wants and needs that it's a cycle that is very viciously, and it victimized youth.
Yeah, I think I told you about my son, too.
Yeah.
He's just got into more problems, just like if he were about 9 or 10 years old.
Yeah.
The guy's 22, and you know, he's just—I don't know what he was taking, you know, smoking marijuana probably, and he just had an accident with his bicycle. He fell off it.
Recently?
Yeah. Yeah, he lost all of his ID and everything. Just went, all his papers were out of his wallet; they're gone. And so he had to go with everything now.
Yeah.
And just, what do you do with it, kid? You know? He's capable, he's gone out and on construction projects, you know, and worked really hard. He's capable of doing things. But neither one of them would take instruction. Because there's just no backup. It's all coming from that, and the television.
Yeah.
What's that? School's the same thing.
They've been
the
same youth.
Thing at school, somebody said walk out of class.
Yeah, being victimized and yes, yeah.
So I've gone over this with administrators. Somebody say, you know, it doesn't make any difference.
You want me to turn this off because now we're talking.
That's all right. I'll edit it.
Okay.
And it's lawyers, sons of lawyers, daughters of lawyers, and doctors. They just screw it up.
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah. You see, what we, and I made a video on this. What we thought, especially the well-to-do folk, thought that their loved ones or their children or offsprings won't be affected with what's going on.
Yeah.
And that's why it is our obligation and duty to care, to do things for those that they can do for themselves, because it affects all of us in a way. Because the children, when they go, you know, they have the same opportunity, except they have somebody to back them up financially, you see. The other ones that they go and do, they get involved in this and get addicted or what have you, they go and steal and, you know, do all this stuff to support their habits. However, once the rich ones, when they get, they are more corrupted because they have the funds now. They go after their parents' money, they go after anybody. And the parents go bail them out and stuff. Okay. So we really, when we go and say, oh, well, we wanted to keep these folk out of the community or what have you, is not, it is a very major problem, because we stop caring about a certain group of people, and then we thought that we're immune because we're going to buy everything. And that's why the children are more victimized when they are from a rich or well-to-do, educated, you know, because they get somebody's backing them up. And then when they, we don't teach them how to live, we don't give them the tools. And when they grow older, they look for mom or dad or whoever they were using and manipulating to, wow. And this.
I was taught to, I got drafted in the army in 1959, I think that that's a good idea, obligatory military service or some kind of national service we had to go in and be disciplined.
Thank you.
Every day.
That's it. In back home, we used to say the same thing. You are not a man until you serve in the military.
Right.
Because it teaches you how to be a man.
Yeah, this guy is on the street.
Huh?
You want to be tough, guy?
Oh, yeah. Who's go on, send him to Iraq.
Get some lead flying at you.
Yeah.
You see how tough you are. Okay. All right. Let's go. Let's talk about... another place. Give me another place you might go. There must be some place where the guy, you know, hand out some free food for you or something. Or did they ever do that?
No, but we're never. Oh yeah. Let me just bring it to Kennedy. It was a courtesy of President of the United States of America. They used to give us biscuits at the school in the elementary school. That is coming from America, and also they used to give us, the milk, the dry milk is like powder, like a formula
powder
thing.
Milk?
Yeah, powder milk. And that sometimes there used to be a helicopter and drop all these packages in the neighborhood.
Care packages.
Yes, and that was from the United States of America. And we used to, very early, 60s, I was like,
You drink powdered milk.
Yeah, I drink powdered milk. To us, it's sweet and it's milk.
Now we send it back.
And we eat it. Yeah, here, now, But that was some that is, it comes to school. It's like lunch. We get a box of biscuits.
Right.
Each one, now, the food back home, everybody was fed, everybody, because people are very generous, people care about one another, in the neighbors, and, in the neighborhood, and so there is no...
So you might be out riding when you your bikes or whatever, just running, walking around as a group, and you stop in, maybe one of your... relatives' houses or somebody?
Neighbors, mostly neighbors.
Yeah,
neighbors. I'm hungry, Mom.
Yeah,
I go to
lunch. Huh?
Yes. We used to do our homework and study at night. We play all day and stay all night, study or do homework, and we get in one of our friends' house. And Mom would be the one that serving us and, making tea and...
Okay, you get together all in one house.
In one house, yes. Okay. Four of us or five of us, we sit there and just study all night and, Yes, yeah. And whatever house that we go to is the mom that is one that is going to be, catering on us, And sometimes the kid goes just to the kitchen and makes sandwiches and, everybody sleeps, so that was another thing. Now there is an incident that is very. I was going to school, and it was Ramadan. Before was it Ramadan or before Ramadan? And everybody in the neighborhood, or it's traditional, they buy the lamb, the sheep.
Mm-hmm.
So they can feed it, keep it a couple of months before Ramadan, and then when the Eid comes, they slaughter. And we were kind of not able to do that, so my dad will go and buy half of, from the butcher shop. And that year, I'm going to school, and it was dark outside. It was like 6:30 in the morning, and it's still, you know, it's in, I don't remember, it was winter, I think. And I got scared because it was a lamb right there in my house, in my stair, after I got out of the stair. Yeah, it was there. So I went there, and I grabbed it. I said, I went back up, Mama. I found a kharuf, you know, I found a lamb. And he said, well, that probably belonged to somebody, you know. So we brought it upstairs, and he said, put it in the bathroom, and we fed it and everything. And I went to school, of course, and I'm very happy. I brought my family a lamb for a Eid, you know. So,
yeah.
And then we kept that lamb for until Eid. And we have tied, you know, there is a plumbing pipe coming out of the house, and we got one with the tied there, and we take it for a walk with kids, go to buy the bread. And one time, he hit the bread bag. It was like the crunchy bread back home. It's like bitter bread, but it's crunchy. And he ate all the bread. And my brother got beat up because why you took that? One asked. We ask all the neighbors, did anybody lost a kharuf? Nobody. Or maybe a chibbered or some, and that was, you know, he didn't even know that, because, you know, it was open, you know, sand. And there was a lot of Bedouins, and they are shepherd, and they used to have their herds, and you know, going all over the place, and you know, that was one of probably, and he got lost, and he ended up in my house, and alhamdulillah.
That's a nice tale.
Yes, and we got. I think my dad hired a butcher to do it, you know, to kill it in the house, and have a very good Eid, and you know, it was very, very nice, and that make me so pleased, alhamdulillah, because I brought my family, you know, it was something that is very significant in my life. Mm-hmm. That I remember. That was nice.
Almost like a folk tale.
Yes.
One of the tales from the Apocrypha.
Yes.
Isn't it? Kind of a secular tale, but maybe there is something.
It was.
Maybe God did bring it for you.
Alhamdulillah. I will always. Okay, there is a thing that I always say. When I move, most of my life has been here in marriage and so on and so forth. And when I met my first wife, and would be moving, it would be raining. And the minute I start taking the furniture down, stop the rain, put it in the truck, and then we go to the other apartment, the new apartment, and we take the stuff. And so as soon as we put the last piece of furniture, start. And I said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, stop the rain for me. And that. Yes. That's why I always say, you got to think that you're special and positive and do the right thing. And when you feel this na'ma or bounties that been bestowed, be acknowledge it and say, oh yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did that for me, because he's merciful, and I am, you know, so.
You know, when I found the $20 bill a couple of weeks ago, he had one of those money clips, and you pull out one, and a bunch of them
Yes!
He was looking for that, but he couldn't find it. It was
nice. It's your
no, God
money.
Gave it to him.
You got gave
it
to him?
It.
Yes.
I needed Subhanallah. It.
Many times, I would be in Santa Ana, and I didn't have a penny in my, and I find $3-4 so I can ride the bus. They drove and right there. And I said, oh. 2, 3, 4, many times. That's happened many times. So it is, we have to recognize these things, and we have to always be grateful for it. Doesn't matter how little and how insignificant you think that it is, but if we acknowledge it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase and will multiply.
Always thankful for life.
Yes. Okay, so you want to stop? This is one of, yeah, we are an hour now. This is the longest one we have. Okay.
Okay. So
now we're going to end this session, and I am, you know, I put the other ones on YouTube, but I'm going to block it, make it only private, so nobody will see it. Okay?
Oh, okay. So it was, I will. Can you show me how to find those?
Okay. Alrighty, now we're going to end this one. It is 12:40 p.m. and this one is an hour, 61 minutes. قولوا قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Shukran, brother Vern. Thank you. And we'll get back. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.